We come to you like the apostles awaiting the Pentecost. We want to see your Son's light dawn on us. We want to see your Son's victory and love our will. And so we beg you, teach us to do whatever he tells us. As we receive the body and blood of your Son in the Eucharist, help us become his hands and feet in our world today. May studying his life make us fall in love with him. May our love for him lead us to imitate him. May Jesus reign in our hearts. Blessed Mother, by your prayers, you open the hearts of the apostles to the powerful workings of the Holy Spirit. Pray for us, O Mary. Help us to listen to the Holy Spirit. Inspire us to bear great things for Christ. St. John.
Pray for us.
Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. St. John. You have two readings from last week? Social justice. It's a Catholic social teaching document number 3, family, communion, and participation. You don't have that one. This is a new one. But you have pages 1 and 2. This is pages 3 and 4. So I just added page 3 and 4 because I found it and then thought, okay, that's just for additional reading. So if you want to go deeper, you can read that. It's a decent little simple summary. It's not what we're looking at in this particular question is a principle of Catholic social teaching that says that basically it's a call to community, which challenges us because especially as Americans, we are rooted in a culture of individualism. That's actually what makes America America. I can go the philosophical roots of that real quick to help you out to understand it. But basically, you take a look and you say, this call to community responds to the question of what is man? Right? And then if you ask that question, it leads you to another question. Whence is dignity? So upon what is human dignity founded? Now, the ways you can answer this are multiple. We, as Christians, answer that question. Excuse me, we only have two markers left, huh? Two colors.
There's, in that closet, there's a whole package of them.
Okay. We approach that question from the Bible. Always remember that. Especially as our cultural warfare becomes more and more pronounced, you will be confronted with the fact that your faith is biblical. This is difficult for people today to tolerate. Because the more that you cling to the Bible, the more that your position will seem to be radical. Remember, you heard it from me, you need to be prepared to die before you abandon the smallest jot or tittle of the law. I really hate to tell you, but we as Catholics believe that the Bible told me that, so I'm telling you, infallible, like the slightest error implied is it. I can go into all of that, but that's a second question. So, but the point is that we look to the Bible for our answers over and over and over again, because like we just kind of forget that. Even in Catholic preaching, we don't really need the Bible. You know, I was just thinking about that, like in all my talks I gave to married couples, you know. I almost went zero into the Bible. I made some like reference every once in a while. It was all like this kind of rational stuff. And why? Well, because that's how I felt like a gravel. Well, if I went to scripture, I'd actually lose them. Is that true? Is that not true? I don't know. All I know is the words. But I also know that the church said, Pope Pius XII said, the preacher whose language is imbued with the Bible will have words that carry with them. And it's just kind of intriguing. So we Catholics kind of like don't really base stuff. When I listen to Chuck Swindoll preach, for example, because his podcast, I'm going to mirror my podcast on his one, the same style, same approach. I went from
commentary on scripture, you know, it's kind of like a problem, right? Because then it ends up that we Catholics are like, oh yeah, I'm supposed to learn the Bible. Yes. When I answer that question from the perspective of the Bible, I come to a very beautiful teaching in the very first pages. And that is, no man stands in isolation. Man is called to community. It's in every single page throughout the scripture. Remember last I gave you like 12 scriptural references that talk about that. We don't start with that basis, and then the culture that comes from it, you know, we can find other ways to answer this question. And the two are not necessarily opposed. I'm going to write them as if they're side, you know, as if they're opposed, but they're not. Faith and reason go hand in hand. So you've got, I would only put like philosophy, and then you've got two currents. Okay. So you've got a philosophical current that corresponds and corroborates biblical teaching. And we're not going to go there. You're going to find it a little bit down in this mess. We don't have time to plunge into it. But also, with just the use of reason, you're open to all kinds of things. That's the Pandora's box. And some uses of reason have a vision of man that does not correspond or corroborate biblical teaching, but instead it's based on, you could almost put, on an ideology. So I'm just going to put the ideologies. Now, by saying that, of course, I immediately make you a Jewish statement about them. That's because I am. So, but you don't, you can take them on and of themselves. But what do these ideologies have in common? They have in common a vision of man that starts from individual experience. And based upon that individual experience, my assumption is that the individual is the basis of reflection. A very common example of this is Descartes, René Descartes. When he asked the question, how do I know that I actually exist? He comes to the answer, I think, therefore, I am. There's other ways to answer that. For example, my mom is, therefore, I am. You know, but like this very emblematically shows you a starting point. Well, the fact is, Descartes' starting point of idealism in the brain, it won the day. If you want to, just as like a little side, there is no one more powerful in the world than the philosopher. I mean, in the common society. So here you link a priest as a philosopher, the war of ideas. The pen is my hero. So actually true. And here's how it works. The philosophers, that includes the good and the bad, and the priests, the idea mongers. Philosophers form politicians. And politicians form laws. And laws form culture. Culture, so / the arts, forms habits or actions. And how does this happen that philosophers form politicians? Education. So this matrix, when it's fully done in line, it creates an ambiance that creates dispositions. Such that when I wrote up here, what is man, I thought to myself, I'm not allowed to write that anymore. That's who? Says everybody. Who's everybody? It's been declared to be wrong to say, what is man? By whom? What judge? Which tribunal? I just know that it's wrong. I'm a sexist because I wrote, what is man, on the board. So here, even here I am, teaching you in total and absolute freedom, able to do whatever I want, writing a word on the board and becoming afraid of its social significance. Whereas 15 years ago, when I was in college, that word was acceptable. I was taught that that's actually beautiful, correct English. It was 20 years ago that I was in college. I had one teacher in college that docked me every time for using that. He said, you're using sexist language. He was the only one. So I said, you can dock me. I refused to bend. So he did. He docked me under one of the papers. And from A to A minus. And he said, because you use sexist language. But he was the only one. So every other teacher totally accepted it. He didn't applaud it. So what changes? This. The culture, the arts, can't even stand the national anthem. The guy, there's a Pittsburgh Steeler, the whole team refused to go the national anthem except one, who was a veteran. And he came out today and he said, I'm really sorry because it made my teammates look bad. So he's bowing too. So now, man, you can't even. Where's that? And where does it all start from? There's an idea that's tough. If you don't have ideas, you don't have laws that have force. You don't have laws. So just sharing that. Because when Descartes puts out an idea, it might sound completely irrelevant. That idea actually won. His idea was taught. It was picked up, this is what's interesting, by the politicians. Ah, this is a way we can circumvent the authority of the church. Because the church has constantly locked us down, Bible, 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 and then locked us down, Aristotle, all this stuff that corroborates it, and we have a free thinker. We celebrate those people. Because wait, he just said that. All of this becomes a nursing thought. And so that gets seized upon, that gets printed, that gets disseminated, that gets picked up and taught as if it's a new avant-garde idea. People start to embrace it in their arts and their cultures to celebrate it, and there's a power to that idea. I remember watching and having a visceral reaction to a commercial that I recommend you all watch just so that you can have that visceral reaction. It was the commercial of the first iPod. By Apple. Unbelievable commercial. I used to play it at Eagle Eyes, just so everyone could get a visual reaction. It's a girl's voice and one of those really like sassy dance thing, like, I am not going to do this. I'm not going to do this. It's like one of those, you're just like, oh my gosh, there's just so much drive and energy, anger and angst, everything wrapped up in that music. And it's got this no face, just like a shadow image, except with the white cord into their ears. And it's individuals dancing, stepping, bum, 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 right with the beat. It's like really a powerful, like, whoa. And it's like got color schemes behind it as you're just seeing these shadows. And I talked to the girl who was part of the team that developed that app. And she said, what we wanted to convey was that when you put on your iPod, you're in your phone. No one. So everyone was listening to their music, you're watching, no faces, you couldn't be identified, and you did whatever the heck you wanted to. You were out of the context of the rest of reality, and you could do what you wanted, and it's very effective. There's a power in that thought right there. It's a power that actually backed up. Well, you all inherited that thought. Because when the politicians got a hold of it, and then the money backers got behind it, so that then they could print it, and they could disseminate it, and create art about it, boom, it started to take off. And philosophically, there's a line between a named Descartes and a guy named Hobbes. And Hobbes, there's a line between Hobbes and a guy named Locke. And Locke happened to be the quote in the Declaration of Independence. This is the pursuit of happiness. Well, the pursuit of happiness is a quote that refers back to Hobbes. Hobbes had this idea that every man was an enemy of every other man. And that the only thing that you could do, crazy is happening, the only thing that you could do in life that you should try to strive for, he says, is contentment. The high point of life is that a man live content. And then he describes contentment very much according to the criteria of the Shire. Each man living in his own house with his own cottage, smoking his own pipe, and planting his own cabbage. Now, to ensure that contentment, I have to have police to protect me from every other man who's my enemy. Because we cannot share the same place. All we can do is live in a disquieting order. Well, Locke comes right from Hobbes. Loves it. Independence. Individualism. And from Locke, you, of course, have... what is that guy's name? Well, you've got all kinds of different political philosophers that then are spawned off. For example, Rousseau. And I keep thinking of this. Mill. Oh, my goodness. Is he ever a disaster? And you might think all these names just sound so historical or whatever. If you listen to a modern atheist guy out there, or even a modern intelligent voice intellectual, they're rehashing what these guys said over and over. Hilarious, you know? He's like a serpentine tongue. He just...
Yeah, it was like the shortest, longest book of my entire life.
He's Mr. Sarcasm. Well, you'll find the exact things. It's almost like there's not even anything new. But at the same time, what they've all done is this is all the thinkers that were right around the time when America was born. And these are the thinkers that the founding fathers referred back to when they crafted the cult, the laws that would enshrine the culture in America. So go ahead, the politicians create laws that create culture, that create habits. I'll give you a very simple example of this. And it's a project I'd like to do as on my bucket list, is read Federalist Papers, where you go back and read the dialogues. But Thomas Jefferson had a big debate with Adam Smith. Because Adam Smith wanted to found an economy, so they were literally crafting, what are we going to be? And Thomas Jefferson is like, there's no better way to live than in the country. Here a man is truly virtuous, a man is truly wonderful and balanced, and a wonderful life, the life of the countryside. So we should build an American economy that would limit its growth, in kinds of industry and everything, so as to foster this wonderfully virtuous, family-based life called life in the country. And Adam Smith said, no, we need to unchain a beast and virtue, not he said, but like, development and progress. That's Mill. So he's like, we need to do this, and we need to, so that we can always have something new developing. And Smith won. Ideas, politics, law, culture, habit. As a guy in the school of business in the Catholic Church in America, where I've got to counter all of this by a class on participation in community. Because otherwise you're going to be Americans more than Catholics. How do I balance that? Every one of us is going to find this debate inside their soul. As you're like, I've got an idea. And then people are like, why would you spend your time doing that? What's more important? Your idea. Develop it. Your feeling. I'm here to help you. Yes.
Political consequences aside, do you think there's a philosophical truth to what Descartes was saying? Because I know that in the phenomenology in JP2, they're taking this idea of self-presence, which can be associated with that, like lateral self-presence is sometimes called, and that's a source of theoretical certainty, a source of knowledge, and therefore it's like
as a starting point.
Yeah, I think Augustine says something really similar. He says, like, even if I err, I'm present to myself as the one erring, or something like that.
Yeah, there's a lot of truth to it. It's just that I was just using it as an emblem of the beginnings of individualism. But there's a lot of truth in everything every single one of these guys say. None of these guys is like the devil. They're all thinkers. It's just that their thought does not necessarily correspond properly to biblical teaching. It will to a degree, insofar as it's true. But it doesn't at the same time. And so that's where you'd be able to criticize it, saying always first what's true and what the philosopher says. We need to be open-minded and listen to all these people because they're all very intelligent, much more intelligent than I am. I don't read any books. Those guys are writing books. So I do. And maybe when I do, then I'll enter a dialogue with them. In the meantime, I bow in humble recognition of their greatness. But I'm also able to critique it and say, and here's where they fell short. Aristotle's not a saint either, by the way. You know, he's done all kinds of political philosophical flaws. It's just that his mindset lends itself more easily to correspondence with the Bible. But nothing rational is infallible on the Bible. And even that needs to be interpreted. That's complex. So thank you for showing that. I'm glad it was a good point. It's a very complex thing. I'm just trying to give it up and get your feet wet. This call to the community doesn't come out of the air. It's not some sort of liberal in the Vatican, social justice, that the liberal guys. It's like, no. There's a question there that begs an answer. What is man and whence his dignity? The Bible is going to give an answer. Say his dignity comes from God, and man is meant by his nature, called ontologically, and by its very being, towards communion, family, and participation for fulfillment. Even a priest is called Father. Celibate. Yeah, Father lives on. I love when people say that. I'm like, I don't have any kids. And I was like, you have so many kids. I think it's beautiful. It's like, what they're saying is, wait a second, don't say you don't have a family. It's like they just immediately rush to that because they recognize that. And I just was like, no. You're sterile. You're sterile forever. Isolation. Could there be something wrong? Man's called to that. Alright, so where and why does the Bible teach that? That's where I'm going to go with this class. So this is just the overview. Now I'm going to zero in. I'm just going to, let's look at the foundations here. Of why this is good. What's the meat to the bones? Because we only have two classes. This is the second one. Got it? Is it? Could I have Gaudium et Spes from someone who already has a copy from last time? Because I passed out two papers. Let's read this together. So this is Gaudium et Spes. Who can tell me who wrote Gaudium et Spes?
Benedict.
Is another answer. Who else has a guess?
Vatican
II. Is the correct answer. Good job. So Vatican II ran from what dates?
62.
Nice job. And Gaudium et Spes was its last document. So when these council fathers met, they met to discuss, write documents. The documents contained their teaching. They all voted on them. That's what this was. And so Gaudium et Spes was its last one. And it means, in Latin, Gaudium.
The joy our joy and hope.
Yes, very good. Thank you. It just means joy and hope. But it's for, good job. I'll take it. Gaudium is joy. Spes is hope. So you hear the word spes when I do that thing in the Our Father. When it's beatam spem et adventum salvatoris nostri Jesu Christi beatam spem, our blessed hope, spem. Okay, so I wanted you to actually read this so you can get into the meat again, reading church documents, seeing where there's a reference point, and it does a great job of teaching this. So this is paragraph 12, 23, 24, 25 and 26. So it's an excerpt from the thing. Okay, so I just jumped in there and grabbed it. Let's read this together, shall we? We'll go paragraph by paragraph and we'll just spin around, starting with Gavin.
According to the almost unanimous opinion of believers and unbelievers alike, all things on earth should be related to man as their center and crown. But what is man? About himself, he has expressed and continues to express many divergent and even contradictory opinions. In these, he often exalts himself as the absolute measure of all things, or debases himself to the point of despair.
Sometimes in the same day.
The result is doubt and anxiety. The church certainly understands these problems. Endowed with light from God, she can offer solutions to them so that man's true situation can be portrayed and his defects explained, while at the same time his dignity and destiny are justly acknowledged. For sacred scripture teaches that man was created to the image of God, is capable of knowing and loving his creator, and was appointed by him as master of all earthly creatures. One, that he might subdue them, or is that a footnote? Sorry.
Yes, a footnote.
Master of all earthly creatures, that he might subdue them and use them to God's glory.
Did you stop? There you have three great preaching points. Remember that we put on human dignity? Here it is, developing human dignity. There's three of them right there. Again, it's really great. So people are like, why should I be Catholic? So let's talk about it. Catholicism says you're capable of knowing God. You're in his image. You're appointed as master of all creatures, that you might subdue them and use them. So that's really a neat perspective. So I said three, but it's actually two. Image of God, capable of knowing.
What is man that you should care for him? You have made him little less than the angels and crowned him with glory and honor. You've given him rule over the works of your hands, putting all things under his feet.
Okay, first point. And now the but is so important. So this is where it's important for this class.
But God did not create man as a solitary, for from the beginning, male and female, he created them. Their companionship produces the primary form of interpersonal communion. For by his innermost nature, man is a social being, and unless he relates himself to others, he can neither live nor develop his potential.
Whoa. You must finish the sentence for me. Man was made a social being who must relate.
He must relate himself to others.
Going.
Or if he doesn't, unless he relates himself to others, he can neither live nor develop his potential.
Give me, let's do a little discussion here. Let's change up our pedagogical methods. What does that mean to you practically?
If you're not in relation to other people, then, it's showing two things that I've seen in, different ways in my life and other people's lives. First you're going to stop developing as a person, and then secondly you're just not even going to be able to survive.
Where did you see that happening? Can you just kind of give us an example?
Well, I'm thinking of a lot of conversations that I've had with college students on campuses around the country over the years, and just meeting students who, one example comes to mind, University of New Mexico years ago, one of our staff members was talking to a freshman girl for a couple of hours, starting out about abortion and then talking about just a lot of things having to do with faith and life in general. And she left saying she had to get to class, but she was like, it was probably halfway through her freshman year, and she's like, thank you so much for taking this time, because she's like, you're the first person who's talked to me. It wasn't me, it was another staff person, but I remember them describing her as somebody, she just seemed really, really down, depressed, alone, and they just spent a whole bunch of time with her, and she, that's the first thing that came to my mind. You just see people, as people, we're going to wither away.
Also, if we're made in the image of God, and God is love, and we're going to develop that potential, you can't do that unless you're living in communion with someone else. Because how are you expressing your love if it's just you? Even hermits learn how to love from a relationship with other people.
I remember a hermit I talked to who said he used to wake up on Saturday nights at 11, and he'd carry the Blessed Sacrament in a walk through the woods for 3 hours to the top of a mountain that overlooked Nice, this town of Nice in Cannes. And he would expose the Blessed Sacrament on a rock and worship him, praying for all of the souls of the young people who were being lost in the cities at his feet. This is an example. To love enough to wake up at 11 at night. Do something crazy like that every Saturday. And I think he said he would bless all the directions of the earth and myself. So I'm not saying it's liturgically correct.
when the angels are the only ones there, certain things can be wrong. What does he think it means? What do you guys think? Give me examples to put yourself in relationship to others. He says man must relate himself to others. What does that mean concretely? For you, how do we relate ourselves? But if you wanted to relate yourself in this sense to someone, what would you do? I think you could say, put yourself in relationship with. How do you form relationships? I would propose something to you guys. I think if you put yourself in a sense of responsibility for the good of the other, like inside, if you're like, I'm responsible for the dishes being washed, or I'm responsible for the joy in the room, like it's almost like an inner choice, I think that's also what we do. Then it becomes the source of many actions. But it's almost like no matter where I go, I'm thinking of my students. No matter what I'm doing, I'm praying for my students. Because inside, I've chosen. I'm like, I am SJI, and you are SJI. And so, I'm related to you. It's kind of cool that, we could do that together, actually. No matter if I'm alone or whatever, if I'm like, no, I've got my family, my student body, my fellow students, my friends. Suddenly, I'm carrying this community inside. I'm participating. Call it participation. Okay, cool. Close that discussion. Yeah?
I just really liked it one time Bruce explained as a mission in new evangelization. It is where he said, you are called to let others know that they are not alone. And that's how he described the mission of new evangelization.
Wow. I also remember one time a woman who kind of had social anxiety. She doesn't know what to say in conversation, so she just sits there. And after we were having a conversation or whatever, and she said, I didn't know what to say, she told me afterwards. So I just sat there and I silently loved everyone at the table. So while I was talking or joking around whatever, she was also in relation, just silently choosing to love that person inside. It's also community. All right, let's get the next nugget. So I think to summarize that, though, I just love that line. Because if I were to put my name there, Father Nathan was made a social being who must relate himself to his students in order to live and develop his potential. So then suddenly it's like, whoa, my community is not like a float-around thing. You know, like, oh, well, I'm here, and I happen to live with the brothers. It's like, no, I need to put them first, or else I also won't exist. And the more that I actually interrelate with them, if that's true, then I actually develop myself more. So I'll become more individual the more I'm communitarian. Cool. And then if I was to develop that in a book, which I'd recommend some of you writing, or a blog post if you're a gifted writer, I would write about that
And I would write about that's the criteria of a healthy community versus an unhealthy one. An unhealthy community, the individual is disappeared. He's squashed. Right? But in a healthy community, the more that I live in communion with others, the more that I discover my own potential. The why. I pick the three principles, and I do a Matthew Kelly talk. I make millions. All right, paragraph 23.
One of the salient features of the modern world is the growing interdependence of men, one on the other, a development promoted chiefly by modern technical advances.
At that time, like this is called the cell phone.
Nevertheless, brotherly dialogue among men does not reach its perfection on the level of technical progress, but on the deeper level of interpersonal relationships. These demand a mutual respect for the full spiritual dignity of the person. Christian revelation contributes greatly to the promotion of this communion between persons, and at the same time it leads us to a deeper understanding of the laws of social life which the Creator has written into man's moral and spiritual nature.
There are laws, that's amazing, laws of social life. What? Martin Hope is going to tell me about that. That's fascinating. Written in my nature? That's crazy. Because that means I can screw it up. Just being social is not a given. Again, read the blog piece, the five laws of making friends. Writing back.
Let's read about this.
Since rather recent documents of the Church's teaching authority have dealt at considerable length with Christian doctrine about human society, this council is merely going to call to mind some of the more basic truths, creating their foundations under the light of revelation. Then it will dwell more at length on certain of their implications having special significance for our day.
So just a little emphasis, you notice this is all Bible, in light of revelation. It's unabashedly Christian, which makes it weak. I mean, it makes it very strong if you're a Christian. It makes it very weak on the outside. But since we're all Christians, let's just feed on truth and be happy. Over to you, Bree. 24.
God, who has fatherly concern for everyone, has willed that all men should constitute one family and treat one another in a spirit of brotherhood. For having been created in the image of God, who from one man has created the whole human race and made them live all over the face of the earth. All men are called to one and the same goal, namely God himself. For this reason, love for God and neighbor is the first and greatest commandment. Sacred Scripture, however, teaches us that the love of God cannot be separated from love of neighbor. If there is any other commandment, it is summed up in this saying, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Love, therefore, is the fulfillment of the law. To men growing daily more dependent on one another, and to a world becoming more unified every day, this truth provides to be a paramount importance. Indeed, the Lord Jesus, when he...
Because I've heard there's a lot of stuff that the political left seems to emphasize today. I remember seeing an ad for CNN at the airport 2 days ago, and it said something like, we are all citizens of the world. New world order, the one world government. I read something that kind of lends towards that. It doesn't, obviously, say that. But you can see, if you could take that out of context, you could use that to justify this thing. Now, why that doesn't hold is because there's another principle called subsidiarity. We're going to have classes on it here. And subsidiarity says that the government needs to let the lowest aspects of society govern themselves. But here, you can see how Christianity, at the same time, there's a tension in Christianity. Because, yeah, I mean, I am a citizen of the world. At the same time, I can't be like, well, Iraqis, just let them die. Because they're Iraqis, they're not Americans, I'm an American. It's like, well, no, I mean, actually quote scripture? What's the scriptural reference for this one human family?
John 13.
Nope, I don't think so.
Oh.
I saw it.
It was
Acts. Can you quote that? What's it quote in Acts?
From one man.
Yep.
Has created the whole human race and made them live all over the face of the earth.
From one man, so we all have a common ancestry, therefore we're all brothers. What's the quote? Acts what?
Acts 17:26.
So that's where you got John 17.
No, I was looking at a couple of paragraphs there.
So just kind of a cool principle. Here you got Vatican II emphasizing this. And the obligation, therefore, for love. And you could look at, therefore, like why racism is wrong. Or why, you know, you could then, when you go to like Catholic immigration, Catholic social justice teaching on immigration is that everyone has a right to anywhere on earth. And governments have the right to control how that's done so that it's done in an orderly fashion. And the conflict between the two, you have immigration policy. So, but it's important because you can't say, well, you know what, we just don't want any Mexicans because they're in Mexico. There's plenty of room in Mexico, stay in Mexico. If the Mexicans want to come to America, they have a right to it because they're human beings. They can't. But we don't have, America doesn't have the obligation to do that in a way that disbalances our economy or the economy good. We're supposed to find that balance. That's what we just need, intelligent, compassionate Christian politicians who will say yes to vote and figure out a way. Take a look at another one of the teachings. Go ahead, Bree.
Indeed, the Lord Jesus.
Thank
you. He prayed to the Father that all may be one as we are one, opened up the
vistas
closed to human reason, for he implied a certain likeness between the union of divine persons and the unity of God's sons in truth and charity. This likeness reveals that man, who is the only creature on earth, which God willed for itself, cannot fully find himself except through a sincere gift of himself.
Okay, that is a little side note. John Paul II quotes that line from Gaudium et Spes something like 50 times. It's his most popular quote that he always goes back to. And it's because he actually wrote it. He wrote Gaudium et Spes. He wouldn't write it, but he was on the committee. So it's kind of funny. So that's just like, there it is. That's a nice little bumper sticker, t-shirt, that quote right there. Over to you, Savina.
Man's social nature makes it evident that the progress of the human person and the advance of society itself hinge on one another.
Wow. Okay, just 1 second. Put that down by man's social nature, my social nature, makes it evident that my progress and the advance of SJI's sense of community hinge on one another. Just to help make a transfer of this into the concrete. Okay, just throw that out there. Go ahead.
For the beginning, the subject and the goal of all social institutions is and must be the human person, which for its part and by its very nature stands completely in need of social life. Since this social life is not something found on him, it is dealing with others. Through reciprocal duty and through fraternal dialogue, he develops all his gifts and is able to rise to his destiny. Among those social ties which man needs in his development, some, like the family and political community, relate with greater immediacy to his innermost nature. Others originate rather from his free decision. In our era, for various reasons, reciprocal ties and mutual dependencies increase day by day and give rise to a variety of associations and organizations, both public and private. This development, which is called socialization, while certainly not without its dangers, brings with it many advantages with respect to consolidating and increasing the qualities of the human person and safeguarding his life. But if by this social life the human person is aided in responding to his destiny, even in its religious dimensions, it cannot be denied that men are often diverted from doing good and stirred toward and by the social circumstances in which survey of our immersed member. To be sure, the disturbances which so frequently occur in the social order result in part from the natural tension of economic, political, and social forms. But at a deeper level, they flow from man's pride and selfishness, which contaminate even the social sphere. Here. When the structure of affairs is flawed by the consequences of sin, man, already born with a bent toward evil, finds there a new inducement to sin, which cannot be overcome without strenuous efforts and insistence.
Okay. So I just put up a little note here that I think is kind of interesting. There's two types of society. One that's part of our innermost nature, the family, and then societies by choice. So if you look at that, that's going to be found on the seventh line down from the top. Second line, so among those social ties, second paragraph, man needs for his development, some like the family and political community, so I'm an American, or I'm a Buckeye, relate with greater immediacy to his innermost nature. So that's why an Ohioan roots from Michigan. He's like betraying something deep inside, you know, because like that's his innermost nature. Others originate rather from his free decision. So our community is one from free decision. That's kind of cool. So the basis of SJI's real community isn't the fact that you enrolled here, but that you choose to carry responsibility. To make this class awesome, because like it's their class, which means it's our class, and the more that it's our class, the more it'll be better both for me because I make it awesome, and also better for you. Free decision. The more that you make that decision, the more the community thrives. Whereas nature just happens. And then what else? Just give me in your own words, Savannah. Can you just kind of summarize a little bit what you read? You can pick out sentences, but like, just say it back to us so it sinks in again. I know. Well, so why don't? Yeah, I mean, maybe those two paragraphs, the last two, among the social ties. Like, what is socialization? Could you tell me what that word means? It's going to be the second to last sentence in the second paragraph. This development. So what is that? Your own needs.
I think it's described it as the love of the other human connection. Not just friendship, but also associations and organizations in a greater scale. And he mentioned that those are increasing day by day, which I guess is true, but that actually struck me as kind of funny because I know that like clubs and groups have much less of citizen participation, at least in the U.S., than they used to back in the day when people would have their clubs and things they remember. So I'm not sure what kind of connection we're talking about here. But
what kind of connections today would be proliferate? What kind of socialization would take place today?
Connection to media.
Do you think that's true?
So those are increasing? Mm-hmm. Yeah, those are definitely increasing. I just don't know for one. To what extent those fall into some category of change.
I know I talked to one of the girls that did Eagle Eye. Is the Facebook, the head of the Facebook team for Juicy Juice. She said that there's 5 full-time employees that run the Facebook page for Juicy Juice. 5. Full-time. So if you imagine that they're making $90,000 a piece, that's $500,000 a year Juicy Juice spends just on its Facebook page. And she explained to me that the strategy is that you want to become a friend with Juicy Juice because Juicy Juice talks to you. So, like, when you, it gives advice, they're posting multiple times a day, advice on parenting, advice on diet,
a joke of the day, and they try to create interaction so that you actually would check the Juicy Juice page, because Juicy Juice is part of my life. That's an example.
Every company's doing that. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of weird. Like, I'm getting parenting things from Juicy Juice and from diaper companies and from...
And it's because they want to make it a persona. And then you create a community. So, like, no, we Juicy Juicers all have the same culture. We are all the...
It's interesting because I think, like, what you're saying, Sam, it's like that... is definitely, like, increasing, right? It's more proliferation of these connections. And then you think even just economically, like, how, you know, way back in the day, it would have been, like, small local economies and are kind of connected to the economy next to them geographically, but now we're just, like, so interconnected worldwide. But how often have you gone across the street and gotten parenting advice from, like, your neighbor across the street, you know? Like, what kind of connections
do you have? I thought it was interesting in paragraph 23, he said, that's what I thought of when you read that. It says, nevertheless, brotherly dialogue among men does not reach its perfection on the level of technical progress, but on a deeper level of interpersonal relationship. And that means me, face-to-face, not Facebook.
Yeah, but I think
that's why people...
Juicy Juice is your friend.
Yeah.
But that's why, like, I think probably even, like, these companies recognize that, and that's why, like, they have, like, they want to create, even on social media, like, a more personal connection. Chipotle used to do that with this guy named Joe, and, like, Joe responded to everything, and Joe was funny, and people would, like, actually get on there and just be, like, writing random things to Joe. I don't know what happened to him, but it was super popular.
Yeah, but what does that mean, like, super popular? I mean, is that your whole goal in life? You want to post something funny so everybody likes it?
No, but I'm saying, like, the companies that can pick up on the fact that even over technology, people are looking for that more interpersonal relationship are very successful in their marketing programs.
So they're teaching us in marketing classes. That's the way to go.
Well, at Eagle Eye, when we did our subscription-based platform, every month I'm going to do a webinar. So actually right here today, Sandy chose the webinar platform. So I'm going to go live once a month for subscribers only. So if you're a subscriber, you get to interact with Father Nathan. I'll answer your questions, comment on the news of the day, etc., on a monthly basis. And that's for that same reason. We want people to form the Eagle Eye culture where they are. So we're trying to reach out and create that interpersonal.
Well, you are trying to raise funds, but that's not all you're trying to do.
No, that's like, exactly it.
Right, yeah, whereas, like...
With
like
Juicy Juice.
Yeah, it's like, they're marketing. I mean, it's, it's clever. They're tapping into what's, like, really core to who we are and how we're created and doing it to make a dollar, which is not in and of itself a bad thing, but it's not a good ultimate end. It's a development.
Let's go ahead and just read 26. We'll finish this out together. Tim?
Every day, human interdependence grows more tightly drawn and spread by degrees over the whole world. As a result, the common good, that is, the sum of those conditions in social life, which allow social groups and their individual members relatively thorough and ready access to their own fulfillment, today takes on an increasingly universal complexion and consequently involves rights and duties with respect to the whole human race.
Okay, so pause there. That was a lot to digest. Can you read for me slowly? Everyone digest these words because it'd be almost something you want to memorize. Like on a final exam, I could say define the common good. That sentence is so important. So give me the definition again.
As a result, the common good, that is, the sum of those conditions of social life.
Chew on that. Sum of those conditions. So, okay.
Which allow social groups and their individual members.
Okay.
Relatively thorough and ready access to their own fulfillment.
Okay, good. And individual members.
Relatively thorough
one of the principles of Catholic social teaching. This is huge. On that document that I put out after the pages 3 and 4 that I just passed out, he emphasizes, he talks about the common good, but not nearly as well. So here are the four terms. Number one, the conditions of social life, which allow, second term, social groups and individual members, what does it allow them? Relatively thorough and ready access to what? There. Okay, let's take a look at those four things. One, conditions of social life. Give me an example, brief, of a condition of social life in your life.
Form of communication now, like mainstream communication.
Okay, communication. Like, suppose an SJI.
Increase of.
What's a condition? What's a condition of social life? Let me rephrase it and be easier. What is a condition in the social life at SJI?
Like that you would participate in that's a condition of the social life.
That's a good way. That's one use of the word condition. But here it's using it in a second term. That's what I'm kind of looking for. So when it says the sum of conditions, what does that mean? Give me an example of a condition.
I'm just thinking the buildings, the schedule, the food, the just all the different ways that money comes in and things are paid for and interactions.
Yep, very good. So actually conditions touch on everything that is material. You could also have spiritual conditioning, the moods or the presence of the Holy Spirit, right? But like here you can think of it as material things. So like a new couch, which tag is still on.
We're still concerning.
Are you?
It. No, I'm just kidding.
The new couch. So when I walked in the room, I'm like, this is so much better. Oh my gosh. What was I noticing? That some of the conditions are now giving you more thorough and ready access to a happy experience. Now, if it was warmer and we turned the heat on in the morning, boom, that's another thing, this is some condition. So that, and I don't have any of this, she has full permission to turn it on. But that's an example of the condition of social life. So as we live, we, meaning both as a group, your class, and each one of us individually, there's going to be things, and everything touches the common. Everything in this endeavor, color of the paint walls, so to the type of the floor, to the cleanliness of the thing, to the sum of those conditions. So it's really kind of cool, which allow a social group, so as a class or individual members, access to their own fulfillment. That's cool. So it means that there's two types of fulfillment. There's a fulfillment as a group, and there's a fulfillment as an individual. It's kind of neat. So they kind of, yep.
We would have to do two, and I'm thinking in our little microcosm, but also society, I'm trying to think of like both at the same time. It's the material things, right? But then also, I mean, it's probably not talking specifically about social interactions, but you can really have access to your own fulfillment if there's like always like oppression or disrespect or just
yeah, I shouldn't have said just
no that. I'm just thinking out loud like is it I'm just trying to understand like what it includes and what it wouldn't
yeah include. Like I would say there for example that a constant negativity about our country, we just can't allow that to constantly be bombarding us in the media. Because it's keeping us all back from pride. So we should censor the media. You know? It's just like a route. But like, that's why governments do censor the media. They're like, it's for everybody's good.
I just heard that what you guys are talking about, Bhutan, with the happiness quotient. Mm-hmm. They would justify their laws based on the idea of the common good. So that they just, now, that thing about the internet is actually true. I read an article in National Geographic about it like 4 years ago, that Bhutan finally opened its borders to the internet. But for years, there was no internet in the whole country. And that's because they were controlling the common good. They were actually saying, people will actually get distracted and not be able to do X, Y, or Z. So the reason why this principle is so important is that all of these other principles, the call to family participation and community, all kind of come back. This is what it is. If you want to do practically foundations, what does this class teach me? I'm just like, if you want to be a member of a community is formed by its common good. So really concretely, the fact that I don't do dishes, bad thing. Every time I walk out of that kitchen, I think to myself, I'm hurting the community. So every time I try to justify, like, well, I need to get my class ready, et cetera. But, like, that's at the same time bad. Why? Because when I'm not there, I've just deprived the community of my presence during a moment of this extra life. Or if I'm late to prayer, I mean, that hurt the thing we share. So when I think of common good, you can think of it as what is shared. So if I'm going to call everyone to prayer, then we all got to be there. I can't be waltzing in 30 seconds late, minute and a half late, end of the hymn. That's why we make the brother kneel and kiss his scapula. Apologize. Because he just sucked a minute of a prayer life away. And it's a serious thing. So you can become scrupulous about it, but what I'm Shane is like, sometimes you're like, I don't know how to form a community. Community is not emotional based. It's practical based. I need to take care of the conditions of the social life that allow everyone, their individual and as a group, fulfillment. So as a class, we need to have discussions. I need to participate. Why? Because that's our common good. There's no discussions. Let's discuss. But be like, ah, then we won't have the joy of the discussion. So I've got to get over myself for the sake of the common good. And when I do that, remember what we said, the more I do community, the more that I develop my own potential. So that choice of a community will make me a better person. And at the same time, like I'm saying, like as an individual, as a group, but then also as an individual, I got to be able to care for the people in my community practically by saying, hey, look, if, I don't know, Regina really needs silence to focus on her test, it's not polite for me to talk. Why? Because we're in the same room. We share that. So I gotta take that. And now do you see how there's a juggling? The juggling here, because well sometimes as a group we need this, but as an individual I need this tension. And there's also a juggling of the social groups and individual members, same thing here. So this juggling between a group and me is balanced with this sense of the common good and my good. And what Catholic social teaching teaches us is that the two are inextricably, which means inseparably. So don't try to find your good outside of the community, but also don't pretend that your good doesn't matter. I'm just pointing out to you in passing that is kind of like what will help you unlock a lot of things in Catholic life. So let me sum up. We've gone, you got four big nuggets from the document itself. So first thing we did is we looked at the genesis of it. We looked at the philosophy and we said, okay, there's, well, we have an individualism that comes to us from our philosophical conditioning. But at the same time, the Bible is really clear that man is made for community. And then I said, let's dive into that and see what it says. And just in that one little document, we found four nuggets of things that it said. It said that man is a social being who must relate himself to others if he wants to actually be here. So you can't deny that you need a community.
And that there's laws to that. I really wish it would develop that law. That'd be kind of cool. It'd be, again, a great little law piece. Right. But then also that community is not just a small microcosm, but the entire human universe, all creatures, all men are created as brothers, and therefore we have to love each other. The fourth nugget is that there's two types of the society, by nature and then by free choice. And then I stopped at the last point just to say that definition kind of is something really bad to understand. Conditions that allow me access to fulfillment. Conditions allow me freedom, access, habits. That become a good reason. Attention to teaching me again. I leave tomorrow.